Hello. In the world of work, a person with a disability will experience common patterns of discrimination. These include high unemployment, prejudice about productivity, and a lack of access. It prompts many questions. Why do more employers not hire people with disabilities? What are the biggest challenges to employing disabled people? Could they just not be bothered? There are more questions than answers, but the discussion will explore issues around disability and employment. So let's meet our panel. We begin with Geraldine McGahey, who is the Chief Commissioner of the Equality Commission for Northern Ireland. Geraldine.
Hello, Paul. Paul, I think this is a really important issue, and I'm really glad we're having this discussion, because currently one in five people here in Northern Ireland live with a disability. They are a very diverse group with a wide range of skills and abilities, but many of them are really eager to secure and retain paid employment. Employment rate for disabled people in Northern Ireland is currently sitting around 37%. Now, that's one of the lowest right across the whole of the UK. Indeed, England's sitting at 54%. So I think something radical needs to be done to address this. But I think focusing our efforts in two key areas will be very beneficial. I think, first of all, we need to raise awareness amongst disabled people about their rights and the legal framework that's there to protect them. But we also need to raise awareness with employers about their legal obligations and the rights that disabled people actually have. I think we need to do something about tackling stereotypes. People have very prejudicial attitudes. They classify disabled people. They talk about what they can and they can't do. And those issues really do need to be knocked on the head, because the UK has signed up to the UN Convention on the Rights of Disabled People. And we need to make sure that the government fulfills its obligations. And I think that's where we go forward.
There, because there'll be an opportunity for you to wax lyrical about all of this during the discussion and the questions that we'll be having. Edith Dunlop is the regional manager of the Northern Ireland Union of Supported Employment. Edith, a little about you.
Okay, thank you, Paul. As you said, my name's Edith Dunlop from NIUSC. We're an umbrella organisation, so we work and represent the organisations that deliver employment opportunities for people with disabilities. So there's a range of organisations right across Northern Ireland covering all areas of disability as well. And their main aim is to help and assist people with disabilities to get into employment, to stay in employment, and also to progress in employment as well. And really, I agree entirely with what Geraldine has said about what are the main challenges and what are the main issues that we need to look at currently at the moment. There is this employment gap, and it's something that we need to be able to address.
These are issues that we'll be discussing over the next half hour or so anyway, and I'm sure you will have your input, something that you will want to say. Christine Sheridan is the Head of Human Resources at Belfast City Council.
Hi, Paul. I'm delighted to be here and to join this discussion today. I think it's really important, as one of the largest employers in the city centre, that we do participate in discussions and that we make it known what we are doing to encourage disabled applicants and employees to avail of the same opportunities that exist for every other person who wants to find a job and maintain a job. And as in my role as head of HR, I'm extremely proud of the work that Belfast City Council do to support disabled applicants and employees. And as we go through, I'll provide some more information on some of the things that we have done to assist this very, very necessary cause.
Christine, thank you very much indeed. And Dermot Devlin is the founder of My Way Access, a disabled rights and disability blog. And he's probably on television more often than I am. Dermot, over to you.
Thank you, Paul. My name is Dermot Devlin. I set up My Way Access was about to help lobby organisations and businesses and things and how to be more accessible for people who are disabled people. As well as that, it's given me an opportunity now, because I'm involved in the Disability Advisory Group as part of OMA Fermanagh District Council. So we would advise on the policy and anything that's missing within the District Council that doesn't meet the needs of disabled people. And on top of that, I'm also involved in the Disability Strategy for Northern Ireland Co-Design Group. So we're working now with the Department of Community to ensure that the next Stormont government will have everything in place in law and legislation to ensure that disabled people aren't going to be left behind in the future and have full access to everything.
Dermot, thank you very much indeed. So very concise there, laying out of the stalls of all of the people who are taking part in this discussion. We now have some questions and we'll give them an opportunity to expand on their knowledge by answering these questions. And I'm going to start with you, Dermot, on this one. What are the biggest challenges facing disabled people getting and keeping a job?
Well, first of all, I just want to thank for inviting me today, because often with these discussions, you know, about disabled people, that disabled people are sometimes left out of the conversation. So it's a credit to this organisation that myself as a disabled person have been involved.
Dermot, it would be hard to leave you out of any conversation, in truth.
Well,
it would be hard to leave you out of any conversation, but go ahead.
But I do think it's important that disabled people are involved in the conversation, because the old saying going, nothing about us without us. From my own experience, I've been a part-time employee now of Home Enterprise, you know, so I've been there for 19 years. Now, it took me almost 2 years to find that employment, because it was very hard, because especially 20 years ago, that organisation don't want to employ disabled people because they have a fear of maybe can they cope, what's the cost, you know, what adaptations need to be made. Mm-hmm.
And sometimes, and did you have to find the job for yourself, or did you get any help?
Well, I got support from the job centre through the programme that doesn't exist anymore called WorkTrack. So they were able to set me up with an interview with Home Enterprise. So I was able to get a 6 month contract from them. Mm-hmm. So I just didn't want to go through that process again. So I sort of used that opportunity to make myself sort of dependable. So they couldn't
and what was it like, the process of going through an interview, trying to get a job? Did you feel humiliated?
Well, frankly, that was my first interview after 2 years, because I was always stopped at the application period, because disabled people, employers get scared of that. And that still happens today. You know, I'm aware of people that I've been chatting to, you know, across the country and across UK and even different places as well, who have experimented, but in the same CV, and when one they would say they're disabled and the other one will say they're non-disabled. Mm-hmm. And they've never got the interview for being disabled, but they've always got it for being non-disabled.
Okay.
So that needs to be looked at.
Edith, how comfortable or uncomfortable are you at hearing what Dermot was saying?
What Dermot's saying, I think, is happening.
But it's shocking.
It is shocking, and it still is happening. And I would like to think we've moved on slightly as well, you know, from 19 years ago, you know, and there are a number of programmes now available to assist people with disabilities to get into employment. And there's a range of organisations as well right across Northern Ireland that are there to help and support people working not only with the individual themselves.
But do you have your work cut out for you whenever you're trying to get your message across to a potential employer?
Yes, I think we do have difficulties with employers, and I think it, as Dermot said, it's a little bit about a fear and a misunderstanding, or the assumptions that that employers have, that if I take on somebody with a disability, will they be one of them? Will they be off sick? You know, will they? You know, will my insurance go up? Will they be able to do the same job as everybody else? And there is no statistical information in relation, or research in relation to that, that actually says that a person with a disability...
Don't jump too far ahead, because those are points that we will be raising in the conversation later on. But how can we help employers to encourage more disabled people to apply for jobs in that case, Christine?
Well, there's a lot of things that organisations can do. We do know that there is a lot of barriers that disabled people will face. One of the things that Dermot has touched upon is that unconscious bias, where we think we know what a person with a disability can and can't do. And again, that is something that we need to do, unconscious bias training, to make sure.
How do you break down that stereotype?
Well, I mean, within my own organisation, we spend a lot of time providing information awareness sessions for managers, for staff. We do targeted training towards certain groups of staff. We also have a disability staff network, which has been in existence for several years now, and it's made up of disabled staff within our organisation. And we work with them to develop and agree action plans of how we can help overcome the barriers.
How do you judge the success of that?
Well, the success is quite hard to judge, and Geraldine, I'm sure, will back me up on this, because in our monitoring forms, we have a question about whether somebody believes they have a disability or not. Now, that's a voluntary exercise where they can declare or disclose that they have a disability. Currently within Belfast City Council, 4.5% of our staff would declare and disclose that information. But I believe, and I'm sure Geraldine will agree, that that figure is probably higher. But again, it goes back to the fact that they feel if they disclose that, that there are barriers put in their way in terms of gaining promotion and in terms of maintaining their employment. So there's lots that we need to do to address that.
And as I said, Geraldine, I'm sure we'll be chomping at the bit here, because if disabled people are applying for a job, at what stage should they disclose their disability?
Well, the Disability Discrimination Act doesn't require them or put an obligation on a disabled person to actually declare their disability. That's up to them to do, but I think it's incumbent upon the employer to make sure that the person, a candidate, feels comfortable and safe in declaring it, that they are reassured that it's going to be treated confidentially and professionally, and it's for their own benefit. You know, an employer.
But it's in an unreal situation as well, because it's a job interview.
It's a job
which
interview,
is not exactly what you would be doing every day of the week anyway. Yeah. So that's an additional pressure, is it not?
Absolutely, it is. And, you know, research has shown that at least 45% of employees do not feel comfortable declaring anything private about themselves, let alone the fact that they've got a disability. And so many disabilities are actually hidden. But the reason why an employer should be asking at the recruitment stage if someone has a disability should be solely about making sure that there is a level playing field for them in the interview process, that they can get there, that they can avail and have the equal opportunity of any other candidate. So that needs to be made clear in the recruitment process. And we do have advice officers here who can work with employers to reassure them about that, to give them advice. And if any person who has been through a recruitment process and feels that they've been disadvantaged, come and tell us. We're here to support you and give you advice and information. And if necessary...
We don't always like complaining.
No, we don't always like complaining, but people have to learn to stand up for their rights. People need to be aware of what they're entitled to. And they have an equal right to anyone else in any recruitment process. And that's what needs to be exerted.
Christine, I'm going to come to you in this one. And this one is specifically to Belfast City Council in that case, okay? What support is available to disabled people and the employer, in other words, you yourselves, in getting a job and keeping that job?
Well, we have quite a number of support mechanisms. Pre getting a job at Belfast City Council, we do a lot of outreach work. We would go out to, and we would work with our employability disability support organisations. We would provide mock interviews. We would go to careers fairs. We would provide shadow work placements. We take in.
Does that mean coming into contact with people like Edith?
It is, absolutely, working with Edith and other organisations. It means providing work placements. We provide about 30 work placements for disabled people per year. We hope to build on that as time goes on. We do the Job Shadow Initiative. We're very
Is that not labour intensive? Does that not cost you as an employer more money?
Well, do you know, I think the benefits from it are outweigh any of the costs. It's something that we do willingly, and we're really keen to do, because I think the more diverse an organisation, the better an organisation is. You get better mix of individuals, you get real strength from that, and actually in terms of making sure that we're doing the right thing, to have those different perspectives challenges everybody, and I think it is a very worthwhile thing, and we need diverse organisations. So I have no issue with spending the time and the effort in doing so. And
Is this music to your ears, Dermot?
Definitely, it's a lot different.
Is it your experience?
My experience in the past, it was a 6-month contract, but I was able to sort of prove my worth when I was there, so it was extended over the years for some, now they're 19 years. But I would be sort of outside real, because I know a lot of disabled people that once their 6-month contract is up, or maybe it was in the civil service 9 months, but they moved on, you know, so they don't really...
They're moved on? In other words, not by choice?
Not by choice. So I think there has to be some sort of... Now, that's not for everybody, but, you know, quite a large number of people...
How does that make someone like you feel?
It just makes
you're treated like a commodity rather than a human being, a person.
Pretty much, because I think it's comes down to, as we mentioned earlier, about the fear with an employer that we'll take this person on for 6 months or 9 months, you know, and we'll get the support for that period of time.
Yeah, in other words, it ticks a box.
Ticks a box, and then, right, time
to move on. But that's not what it should be about. Surely not, Edith.
No, it's definitely, we should be looking for sort of long-term employment. That's really sustainable employment that we really want for people. There are a number of schemes that are available out there that are there to support people with disabilities, which the organisations use as well, such as the Workable NI programme and the Access to Work programme run by the Department for Communities. And those programmes are there to sort of to support individuals as well as support employers. But there is a time limit on that as well. Sometimes with Workable NI, it's for a year, but it can be extended. But those jobs are paid jobs in the open labour market, which is the key on this, and they're sustainable jobs as well. And then the support organisations that are there, they're very much working with the individual, working with the disabled person, building their skills, their employability skills. And employability skills are really important in going into work. Sometimes we always very much focus on the qualifications and the skills, but really it's about, you know, how can somebody get on in the workplace as well?
Well, let's go one step further now, because this was something that you talked about as well. Sometimes a person with a disability might have to take periods of sick leave. How do you manage that?
Well, in relation to that there, once again, is their employer assuming that an individual, a person with a disability, will be off sick longer than other people's?
That's wrong. That's negative.
Yes,
it shouldn't be.
That's a negative assumption that other employers are making. So you have to look from an employer's perspective. You know, somebody can be off sick, a person without a disability, for many reasons as well. So it's really treating people equally. And really within, you know, anybody's company's sick regulations or what they're using, they should be equally right across for everybody, including people with disabilities.
But is that a concern of Belfast City Council, the fact that somebody might be off for a period?
No, I think, as Edith has mentioned, that anybody can be off sick for any reason. Within Belfast City Council, we have an attendance policy which has a number of support mechanisms in it when we're dealing with someone who's disabled who is off on sick leave. We would engage with the support organisations to understand the very unique needs, sometimes with the individual concerned. We have an occupational health service. We have an employee counselling service. We extend trigger points. We apply discretion in terms of applying the attendance policy. And we have phased return to works, more flexible working, all of those initiatives which are there to keep the person in employment. Because once you have somebody in employment and the value that you get from training them and they're productive in the organisation, it's important to keep that skill. And by making sure that the support mechanisms are applied, we can maintain, and we do maintain, that employment for that individual.
Business has never been under as much pressure as it is now. It's sometimes convenient to say the bottom line, but what is the bottom line? It's not always about money, but certainly you need money to run a business. What do you say to a potential employer who is afraid that it's going to take more of their resources than they can afford to deal with employing somebody who is disabled?
Well, what we would say is that by making reasonable adjustment at the outset to accommodate a person who has any form of a disability will actually perhaps even negate the whole issue of sickness absence. Sickness absence can be avoided as a result of proper measures being implemented, whether it's flexible working, whether it's working in a particular setting, whatever is relevant to that particular person, because it's about keeping them in a job. And the benefits, as has already been said, far outweigh the costs that are involved in actually employing someone.
But you always have to be taking the long view in that, do you not? And that's not always easily done.
No, but if you understand the needs of your employees, if you have a full picture of the needs of every employee, you can manage your output, your work, your programs to accommodate that and make sure you get the best from your employees. And the truth has to be said, Paul, if an employer goes that extra bit to make a reasonable adjustment for an employee, that employee is likely to pay them back tenfold. They will go the extra mile for them. They will build up the reputation of that organisation. Word of mouth, what people see actually pays dividends. And depending on what business you're in, you know, you can tap into a very valuable, lucrative market. You know, disabled people contribute, what, $249 billion to the UK economy. You know, who wouldn't want to tap into that?
But we have been living with COVID, and in these COVID times, there has been a problem. There has been an impact on anybody looking for a job. Can I ask you, Dermot, the effect that COVID has had on you and your ability to work?
Well, I've been quite lucky in respect that I've been able to work remotely from home through Zoom and Microsoft Teams. Now, but I'm sort of been furloughed at the same time because of the amount of work that's been available for me to do. But when the work is available, they can take me out for that day or for that week or whatever to do the work remotely from home. And I think this is a great opportunity for disabled people in the future that, you know, cause my big fear is, and many disabled people fear is, that once the pandemic has sort of gone away or come to a safe level, that these Zooms and stuff will be done away with, and that'll disabled employees will lose that opportunity to work. Now, I've been very lucky with some enterprise that in the past, as we spoke earlier about maybe taking prolonged sick leave, that I've been working remotely for maybe a week or two at a time over the last 19 years remotely, which was quite progressive for Foam Enterprise at the time. So we've been doing that for 19 years before the rest of the world caught up. and I would love that all our employees across the country and across the UK and across Ireland and the world will take that as an example and use that as an opportunity.
But it may not work for everybody. And is there not a danger of social isolation if you are working from home rather than going physically into an office?
It is now, but I wouldn't use that as an opportunity, right? This disabled person can work home every day. That's sorted. We don't have to look at the office. That's an opportunity there that if I'm feeling unwell for a week or my pains flare up that I physically can't go because I'm unwell or in too much pain, there's that option there for me to work at home. That I'm not losing out on working, and they're not losing out on me doing the work that I'm supposed to do. So it's a bit of flexibility for both of us.
Well, aren't we all in that situation at the moment, Christine, where we're trying to find out what is the new normal and what is possible? Can we work from home? Can we work from the office? Can we balance the two?
Yes, that's the key question for all organisations. I mean, for Belfast City Council, we had to adapt really quickly on the 23rd of March. 2020, whenever everybody was sent home, it was like, right, everybody home except those very essential frontline services. And then we had to work through that. And I think throughout the pandemic, we have learned that we can be more flexible as an organisation. And I think that's a good thing when we're assisting staff who are disabled, who, like Dermot has said, maybe have a flare-up of a condition for a week. Before that would have been a week's sickness leave, but you could work from home because you're not having to make that commute in. It's not an effort. But I'm also a bit concerned about the lack of social interaction and the isolation from home working as well, because I know and I hear across the organisation that some people have found it very, very difficult. And so flexibility in terms of being back into the office, but also realising that if you have to work from home for a period of time, that it can be done.
We don't live in a perfect world, Edith. And that being the case, even though your organisation is there to help, the reality is that on the ground there will be banter and there will be harassment. How do you cope with that? How do you handle that? How do you stop it from getting out of hand?
Well, once again, it's obviously going through sort of through HR as well to sort of raise those issues and making sure too, I think, as everybody says, that individuals are comfortable enough as well and feel secure enough in talking to their HR department or their line manager initially, and then going through to the HR and looking at the systems and process that they have in place. You know, unfortunately, that in some situations, that is the banter in the workplace. But we need to address it, because once that banter maybe gets out of control and how people are feeling, you know, very much it will put people off and people will leave their work and as a result of that. So it needs to be addressed, and it needs to be addressed not only on those instances, but also right across the organisation as well, because the organisation needs to ensure that's not the type of environment that we want to be.
But there are no two ways about it. Mm-hmm. It's illegal.
Absolutely, it's illegal. And we would love to hear anyone who is experiencing harassment or victimisation or bullying in the workplace, please come forward. Because an employer has a duty to make sure there is no such behaviour taking place. They have a duty to make sure that the policies and procedures are in place, that all of the staff are aware of it, not just senior managers in terms of implementing it, but everyone knows. But people with disabilities need to know that they have a right to be protected from that. And we would love to hear from anyone who's experiencing such behaviour, because, Paul, I think it has to be said that society as a whole, there have been so many incidents of bad behaviour towards disabled people.
Yeah. It's shocking.
Absolutely, it is shocking and it's horrendous. Social media is a terrible platform for it. And I think employers really do need to take the bit between their teeth here and make sure there are proper policies and procedures in place. Good employers have it. They build up trust and respect with their employees, all of their employees, regardless of their abilities. And more employers need to take the same lead.
There are good and there are bad
Absolutely.
Out there. It must be very frustrating for someone like you.
It is frustrating, but we have a really good team here of advice officers who will help anyone, any employer in that situation. There's training available. We have a really good legal team and discrimination advice officers who will help guide someone through how to deal with such experiences. So we're here to help.
How do employers and employees and statutory bodies and the third sector work? How can they work better together in order to close the skills gap?
I think that one of the main things is about working together, you know, because you have,
Do they always want to work with you?
Well, yes, we've had a very good relationship with many employers, and we work very well too with the Equality Commission and as well as with the Department of Communities, and we all work together. I think because we realise as well for an employer, there's a lot of information out there and there's a lot of services out there too. And it's trying to sort of help them navigate through that as well and the different programmes that are available and also about providing that advice. And I think having that good sort of three-way, which is there to help the employer and which is also there to help sort of individuals as well sort of navigate through getting into employment is essential. And organisations do work very well together. We could be doing a lot more and we definitely intend to do a lot more work, like events like this and other sort of conferences and sort of always working along with employers. Many of our organisations work on a very individual basis with employers and about getting an individual into employment. And then we work sort of strategically too with sort of the larger employers to sort of look at sort of positive action measures that are there to help to get people into work. And just one of the things that you'd mentioned earlier on was in relation to sort of the recruitment process, and Paul, you'd mentioned it as well. Things like, you know, if we're talking to employers, we would try to raise with them and taking on positive action rather than having the routine interview. What about a work trial, you know, for somebody with a disability, not having to go along to that interview, that 20-minute interview that will maybe change. It's a very unnatural environment to be in. But why don't you let the person themselves go along to do the job over a period of time and then make that the assessment for the interview? And that works really, really well. And that's something we can get across to employers as a really main.
Dermot, you have been very vocal over many years about the needs of people who have a disability. Is it about you, because you are a person who is disabled, or is it about trying to create a more level playing field for others who have a disability and who may not have thought of being as articulate as you?
Well, the way I look at it, I don't do it for my own personal thing. I'm sort of one of the few people that sort of has been quite lucky in that respect, and I feel it's my obligation to open the door and bring other people with me, so that's why I'm sort of advocating on their part. And I think it's very important, like where I work, it's been great, and they would get support, and I would get support from UCL and as well as from Access to Work. So, and it's quite fluid, they're working together, it's not like they're all sort of competing with each other, and I think that's very important.
I think we in the media have an important part to play too, because, you know, you're no stranger to television audiences. And I just hope, do you get the opportunity to say what it is you want to say?
I do, because I think it's not about, you know, that disabled people have to be the front and centre of everything. It's not about that, it's about a level playing field so that we're going to be treated equally and equality. So it's not saying we're going to have this person who's disabled and before somebody who's non-disabled. You have to ensure that the needs are there for everybody. And I think it's very important, like particularly with an event like today, but also with all these different organisations, the disabled people need to be involved in these conversations, because for too long we've been left outside the conversation, and people who are non-disabled are building programmes around us, and sometimes it doesn't always fit. So if we're involved in these conversations, mm-hmm. we can say, well, this isn't working for us, but this is what actually does work for us. And it will build a better conversation and build better program for the future.
That brings us almost to the end of this interview. But what I want to do before we wrap it is to allow each of you to give us your concluding thoughts on what we've discussed today and what your hopes would be for the future. Geraldine.
I think my burning key issue would be to ask government to fully implement a resource their disability employment strategy. I think Dermot has made it very clear that their voices need to be heard. Everyone's voices need to be heard, and it's don't do anything to someone without involving them in it. It's as simple as that. And I think everyone in society has a right to feel valued, to contribute, to feel they've got a purpose. And one thing I would stress is it's paid employment. It's not a meagre token gesture. People have a right to be equal citizens, and that's what we want to see happen.
Edith.
I just concur with everything you just said there, Geraldine. Very much so. It's about getting giving people with disabilities the same opportunities as everybody else. And that's really all that everybody is asking at this stage. And yes, it's very clearly is about paid employment as well, and paid and sustainable employment. So we would really hope from today that, you know, we've all got together here, very much taking on board what Dermot has said. It really is, you know, people with disabilities need to be in the centre of all of this as well, and in particularly in designing those programmes as well.
Well, you will have the last word, Dermot, but before that, Christine.
Absolutely, I agree with both Geraldine and Edith. I mean, for me, as a HR professional, I've learnt firsthand that having our disabled employees run the Disability Staff Network, tell us what programmes they need, because like Dermot said, we can't assume to know what works for certain individuals and what doesn't work. So involving them in developing our action plans has been a key success of the organisation, because they are the individuals who are saying, this is what we need. We need more of the mock interviews. We need more outreach work. We need the guaranteed interview scheme. We need shadow placements. We need more support when we're off sick. All of those things we have done working with our disabled employees, and I think that has made us a better organisation. And I think more collaboration among ourselves, employers, the Equality Commission, the supported employment organisations.
What works in Belfast must also work with the other council areas.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I know other councils work really hard as well to make sure that they're doing the same thing. And I think it is just making sure that the key players, all those stakeholders who need to be involved, are involved in all the conversations.
That includes politicians.
It absolutely
and
does.
And I just have to ask you, Dermot, what do you think of our politicians whenever it comes to the championing rights that are important to you?
I think, and I make it a bit controversial here,
but I don't mind that at all. I think you got to say it like it is, because you're the guy who's centre stage.
Well, I think they're saying the right things in the media, and when they're on the TV, they'll say the right word, they'll say what they want to do in the media.
Are they not delivering?
But whenever it comes to practicalities, it can be quite frustrating.
So what would you suggest? What would you be saying to the politicians?
Well, I think, like, for example, the disability strategy that I'm involved in, so we're trying to build a new strategy so that the politicians do know what needs to be done. But a lot of people feel, not just within strategy, but in other aspects, that right, we've got disabled people in. Okay, we've ticked that box, but it's very important that the politicians and employees and organisations as well.
Do they return your calls whenever you ring them?
They do, but it's whether they actually implement what we say. And that's the thing, they might just, a lot of cases, it's a tick box, right? We've done that, we've got the disabled person involved, this is what we will do. And I think they have to listen to and implement what we have to do, because in the future you're just going to create more problems if you don't listen to us.
Dermot, thank you very much indeed. And to Geraldine, Edith and Christine, thank you as well. And finally, people with disabilities tend to experience high unemployment, have lower earnings, are often relegated to low-paid jobs, are underemployed, become discouraged, they drop out. Yet, experience shows that when a person with a disability finds a job suited to his or her skills, that person can make a significant contribution to the workplace. All they want is the opportunity. Now, it's over to you. Thank you for watching. Thank you all very much indeed for your contributions today.